Digital disruption is happening in every single industry without any exception.
Be part of the transformation.
More control, more security, more visibility.
It's really exciting to see all of these ideas being exchanged in one place. It's been a great experience. I love being at Box.
Every year it just gets cooler and cooler. It gets bigger and bigger.
They're fundamentally changing the fabric and culture of society.
To be able to do that, you have to invent yourself into this market.
Companies like GE,
Coca-Cola, legal,
going to go with Uber, three different things. History of the company and some stats, what we do, and talk a bit about Box. So let's first talk about the practice of the future. In the past, physicians used to be able to get up from their desk or from wherever they were and literally see the patient and interact with that patient, giving that patient all of their attention. Looking now at the way that things are set up in the industry, there are lots of disparate systems separated completely. The data is essentially siloed, where you can't transfer medical information from one silo to another. A lot of the healthcare industry is also driven by fax. So physicians are inundated with paper, lots of paper. What a physician really needs to do is focus on a patient with the allotted amount of time that they have. So physicians are quite confused with electronic medical records, with paper, with these disparate systems. I'll give you one example, a cow. Not this type of cow, this type of cow, a computer on wheels. A computer on wheels is something that a lot of physicians use in these large facilities. What it does is it locks the physician down so they can't actually go room to room or go out of the hospital and look at medical information when they need it. So a lot of the time they're pulling up information when the patient is in front of them. What we're looking to do is take the physician and create a mobile experience for them. Here's an actual example from one of our customers, evofoot.com. This physician is actually using an iPad and they're able to walk from room to room with an iPad. How do we fix this problem? We are focusing on building a cloud infrastructure, creating digital health records, not paper, rethinking design. So I'm gonna talk about some history and some stats now. DrChrono was founded in 2009 by me and my co-founder, Michael. We have over 10 million patients in the platform. That 10 million is 3% of the US population. How many patients in the US actually have visits? There's a little under a billion visits from patients happening in the United States today. How many patients does DrChrono have? We're booking around 800,000 appointments per month. That means it's 1% of the US population. We created the first iPad EHR as well. So to give you a little history on the iPad, it came out April 2010 when Steve Jobs announced it. There was a line to get the iPad, and we were on the iPad day one. Here's the iPad, the first day we launched it. Here's what our iPad app looks like today. We have a whole suite where you can focus on the web through a laptop, the iPad, as well as iPhone for physicians. We're really thinking about simple design to have as few taps as possible. We partnered with Apple in their mobile MPP partnership. We're also ranked by 20,000 medical professionals in the industry from Black Book rankings as the number one EHR. We're also ranked best in class 2017. And we're the best reviewed EHR at the Apple App Store today. So I'll walk you through the care journey of how a patient actually experiences the patient experience. So they first, from home, can fill out their forms, message their physician, see information like labs from their mobile device, their iPhone. They can also do this from the web. When they go in after scheduling an appointment, they can actually take the check-in app that DrChrono has and fill out forms straight from the check-in app in the waiting room, taking a profile picture and uploading their insurance information. At the point of care, the care team will interact with the patient, and this is probably one of the most critical points where the physician needs a good device to input as much data as possible for the patient. And when they're doing that, it triggers multiple billing events for the billing team to fill out that information. All of these are apps as well in the App Store. As you can see here, we have our patient app, our check-in app, our point of care tool, and our billing tool. We also focus on medical billing and surgical center billing, so you have options as a physician. We have a free plan. We also go to different tier plans. We focus on all specialties and all size practices. Think of us as a platform. We have an EHR, we have a billing component, we have a patient app, we have an API, so apps can build on DrChrono. We're on a mission to make an open EHR, and that's where our partnership with Box comes in. I'll give you one example of how you can share medical data to Box. You go into the patient's chart, you can pull up a note, tap the share button, share to Box. It pulls the information right into Box. Let me show you one other way that you could sync. On the settings page in DrChrono, go to the services, select Box, hit connect, connect it to Box. You can sync all patients or some patients. We sync at the point of care where the physician and the billing team can connect to Box and sync data across the two platforms, making a seamless experience. We also connect metadata. So if there's specific information like that this image is an X-ray image, that will also be pulled into Box. We're also thinking about deeper integrations, like pulling in DICOM images from Box. Thank you very much.
All right, hey everybody, so we're gonna get started. I know you're probably a little bit comatose after lunch, so we're gonna try to keep it pretty dynamic. Hope you guys are all here for Doubt Cloud in Healthcare, how to solve the puzzle of innovation. If not, you may need to not be in this room if you're not here for this session. So this is really going to be a follow-up after the session yesterday. So yesterday we had a number of CIOs up here. We really talked about how to challenge your existing organization's perspective of what's possible in healthcare and what the potential is, especially because there's so many regulations and restrictions. And as I think John S. on the far right said yesterday, we're kind of 45 years behind financial services. We're in like the age of the ATM before mobile apps happened. And so today, what I really wanted to dive deeper into was what are tangible ways that each of your organizations can really take that a step further. So whether that's through an integration or through system integrators or building customizations, we really invited a number of our partners up here on stage to talk about what that really could look like for you guys. So from yesterday, what we heard Aaron really dive deeper into is that we know business is getting more connected. People are becoming more mobile, more remote. It's just harder to be able to support that from a technological perspective. And then add an additional layer of the regulations that healthcare really has. It's becoming increasingly more complex. And we saw this, you know, in Aaron's keynote, where there's more and more dispersed areas of content. And then within healthcare, what that means is you're seeing both structured and unstructured content from the medical record, from the claims process, wherever it is that you're looking at information, it's increasingly hard to find and increasingly hard to know exactly what to do as a different end user, especially when you're a physician or you're on the care team and you're just trying to help your patient out. You're just trying to make sure that they get the care that they need. So today that's exactly what we're going to dive into. Yesterday we talked about the vision. Today is really going to be how can I tangibly meet that vision? How can I work in the technical stack that you have to be able to increase productivity? Be able to have those intelligent business processes that David and the two John S's yesterday talked about. I mean, really, how can you ultimately create an engaging digital experience? And each of the guys have worked with some of our clients at Box, as well as created their own visions to be able to do that. And so I invited each of them to kind of play out different aspects of what we see in healthcare, from communications to EMR to building out different customized integrations. So that's really the focus of today. It's going to be really diving deeper into tangible solutions. Also, we are going to have longer audience Q&A, since some of you yesterday came up to me and wished that you had more time to ask questions. So that'll definitely be possible at the later half of the session today. So with that in mind, I'm going to introduce this lovely panel that I brought up here. It's not going to be as confusing yesterday. There's no exact same names. No two John S's this time, so hopefully it'll be simpler for everybody involved. So first with me, I have Jonathan. Jonathan is a director at TigerText. He leads partnerships with a number of healthcare tech companies over there at TigerText, from system integrators and different channel partners. He's also responsible for building new solutions and products through a number of strategic companies such as Box, which is, of course, you know why he is here, but also companies like Samsung. So really pushing the limit in terms of what is possible for communications, because there's so much information that I think happens between a physician to physician or within the care team that isn't really properly protected, but also isn't as intuitive when I used to work in the hospital, I'd see sticky notes everywhere because physicians and nurses are just, and I see nods in the audience because we see that too when we're seeing our own physician. So personally, I also think that in healthcare, we don't think about the overall holistic business. Another reason I invited Jonathan onto the panel was because he really does that. He came from the tech industry, got an MBA at Wharton, and is really focused in terms of what the business plan is in healthcare, how to be able to have improved customer relationship management and go-to-market strategy. He also is a little bit of a secret nerd, so if you enjoy talking about APIs, he really welcomes those conversations after this event. And I'll let him actually speak a little bit more about TigerText.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us here. We're big fans of Box at TigerText, and Rachel, we really appreciate it. Before I get started, I just wanted to ask the audience, like, who works for a provider or healthcare organization here? A couple here. Excellent. So TigerText is the leader in clinical communications and collaboration. What that means is that we have mobile apps, and we have apps that work either on a desktop browser or in a PC that you can download. It enables collaboration between doctors and nurses. You can chat back and forth. You can send files and images. We're the leader in our space. We've been at this for about 10 years. We've got 3,000 organizations across the United States, so we're exclusively focused in healthcare, and we're exclusively focused in the United States for the most part. What I do at TigerText is work on all the partnerships for the ecosystems. So we'll go out to a site, we're a cloud system, we sell software as a solution. We'll go out and map the ecosystem and try to figure out all the different workflows that we're trying to solve for. Whether that is, you know, ROI around patient journeys or anything like that. And that ecosystem is really challenging. So we come, I don't know if you guys, if there are people here from Silicon Valley, when you enter healthcare, you have a lot of conversations about on-prem software versus cloud. So we really are taking a journey backwards in time to solve some of these very challenging use cases. Some of the customers that we work with are down below. I lost my notes.
I did warn him before.
You warned me. You did warn me.
Are you sure you want to bring paper on stage? We are a cloud company.
I didn't want to. Daniel's got it on his mobile app. That's very good. So you can go to the next slide now. So what do we do? So we're a communications layer, we're an infrastructure layer. So we get data from all sorts of different point sources, whether it's the EMR, whether it's bed flow or patient management software. We can take pager data and actually get all those pages routed into TigerText, so you can actually ditch that pager. You can even do things like send faxes into TigerText. At the end of the day, what we're doing is trying to solve for these really hairy workflow situations. So trying to coordinate care around a patient, trying to discharge a patient faster so we can free up that bed, get that patient back home, reduce their risk of exposure to all sorts of things that are floating around in a hospital. And those are, we have, I think, 120 different workflows that we have documented that our clients use, and we have use cases around nursing populations, we've got use cases around doctors, EVS, transport, all of the above.
Awesome. And I think one thing that, you know, we often forget when you're thinking about communication is that there's a lot of content associated with that. And it's content that's also regulated. And so being able to do that from a secure platform is really where a partnership with TigerText arose. And so when you're thinking about this overall healthcare approach, what happens in healthcare, what happens in a provider or a payer, you'd be remiss if you didn't think about the medical record. And that's really why I brought Daniel to this panel. I think that they really have come up as a differentiator when you're thinking about EMRs. If you were at the session yesterday, you heard me introduce myself, which I decided not to do today. but I used to actually work for a major EMR company. And it's hard because everything is so structured. It's highly regulated, and there's so much information that's necessary, especially when I was working with my different providers. And I think that Daniel really changed that with DrChrono. He is the co-founder and CEO of DrChrono, but his focus has been in the tech space since 2001 as a software engineer, designer, and entrepreneur, of course. His mission has been to make healthcare simple, bring innovation to healthcare, and in April 2010, that's why he launched DrChrono, which was the first iPad EMR. And now, you know, 7 years later, it's expanded beyond just that EMR platform to be available for thousands of physicians and over 10 million patients. I don't see too many boxers in the audience, but I didn't tell you this, Daniel, but I actually was very interested in DrChrono. I almost applied after I left my last position before I moved to Box. But now instead I get to interview and grill you about DrChrono instead, so maybe it's evened out. One more thing about Daniel is that health science degree actually voted him as one of the most highly influential healthcare entrepreneurs. And for all of those in the room that maybe have your own healthcare company or are thinking about starting your own healthcare company, he actually is a startup school advisor at Y Combinator as well. So that's something that we'll be highlighting today if you want to talk to him afterwards. So I'm going to let Daniel actually introduce DrChrono.
Sure. How many people here know what an electronic health record is? Everyone in the
room.
That's
good. We're in the right audience.
So DrChrono, I think it speaks for itself since everybody raised their hand. DrChrono is a medical records platform for physicians, for staff, for patients. I would say there's a lot of EHRs out there that adversely hurt the patient-doctor experience. And what we're trying to do is create a better experience for physicians where they can interact with their patients. There are a lot of physicians, so say you're a patient, a lot of them are furiously typing, or they hire a medical assistant who comes in and sits there and types for the physician. We're trying to remove all of that, allowing the physician to interact with the patient face-to-face. So DrChrono, that's what we do, and there's a lot of custom configuration that we do on our end, and I think Rachel had mentioned some things here. We have over 25 million patient appointments booked in DrChrono. Roughly around 1% of the U.S. population per year is booked in our software today. We have 10 million patients in DrChrono, and that is 3% of the U.S. population. We have medical claims, so we also do the practice management side, so it's a full ecosystem of a suite, tightly integrated. So we have 1.5 billion in medical claims being submitted into DrChrono per year.
Awesome. So it sounds like we have a pretty decent impact, I think, when we're looking at these numbers. So I'd also be remiss when you think about what's happening in healthcare, outside of communications, outside of structured information in a medical record, and then unstructured information outside the medical record, to forget about how many integrations truly happen within a payer or a provider space. There's so many different incoming information, whether it is through billing, through scheduling, through communications, even outside of that, when it comes to finance, regulations, health information management departments. There's, I would say, innumerable amounts of integrations that I had to deal with when I used to work on the provider side. So I really wanted to actually invite two different system integrators to the panel to be able to talk more deeply about that. The first is going to be Nick. He's the CEO of Smashing Boxes. He is a lifelong entrepreneur. He actually founded Smashing Boxes as not just specifically for healthcare, but really as a product design and development agency that employs over 40 plus designers, developers, strategists, and growth teams. And I think you guys heard me mention yesterday, a lot of times when you're looking at healthcare, you're so stuck within the box. That pun is not intended. But really because you're so used to what you see on a day-to-day basis. You're used to the physicians, you're used to the EMRs, you're used to the hundreds and hundreds of integrations they have to build. And a lot of times we may lose sight of the fact that it's not as intuitive to the care team. How well are we thinking about the overall care continuum? And I think what's interesting about Smashing Boxes as well as with YML, which I'll introduce Raina in a couple moments, is that they aren't so focused in just healthcare. They're looking across other regulated industries and seeing what other regulated industries are doing, especially because they oftentimes are thinking outside of the box and they can bring those best practices over into healthcare. So specifically with Smashing Boxes, they're known for creating award-winning and innovative digital products and solutions. They work with a number of healthcare clients within Box to really challenge them and to rethink and reimagine how a patient needs to interact with that content. Named one of Entrepreneur Magazine's best entrepreneur companies. That was a little repetitive, but it makes sense. And as well as Inc. Magazine's top 5,000 list, Smashing Boxes is headquartered in Durham, North Carolina, but they work across the company. So I'm going to actually let Nick talk a little bit more about those use cases here.
Nope, that was it. Just kidding. We're a software design and development agency. We build apps and products for people or companies with ideas. This is a high-level list of a few clients. FHI 360 is in the public health space, so they do a lot, globally, well, they have a domestic and a global department, but that's publicly funded stuff for underserved communities. Think Africa. So one project was a contraceptive initiative, just trying to distribute information via the web to people who need it, and then also to collect information to turn around and display to their funders. Duke is a client, so they, one of their leading physicians, launched the Practical Playbook, which was to encourage more cross communication between public health and private practitioners. So, helping private practices or clinics identify trends, you know, like I'm seeing a lot of asthma patients, and being able to then turn around and talk to the public health places to say, you know, what kind of materials can you put out about allergies this season? We do stuff with IoT as well. So Phononic is a maker of, well, they make a lot of stuff actually, but they make a medical fridge that's IoT enabled, using their technology that's like a motorless sensor, and they're a big applied sciences company. But anyways, so we help them build an interface that connects with their fridge to monitor temperature remotely, so you're not having to constantly check it, because these are valuable materials if you're in the medical space. So is there another slide? No, cool. Okay, so that's it. Yeah, we do stuff, like Rachel said, across industries. So it's not just healthcare, it's not just enterprise, large companies, large institutions. We also work with one-man or one-woman startups. So I think that variety provides a nice balance on the panel.
Yeah, and I think when we move over into the other system integrator that I invited in, Y Media Labs, it kind of highlights the other side of the spectrum. So when we're looking at Smashing Boxes, a lot of what they did at Duke, but also at a large cancer institution in Texas that will not be named, they really dive deeper into what is in their technical stack. Versus when I think we're looking at YML, they're looking across, they're looking at overall design, increasing intuitive user experience, and with me from YML, I have Raina, who is the director of strategy, and she comes with 10 years of experience across product development, business strategy, people management. She's worked with Apple, Hospital Corporation of America, also known as HCA, Dolby, First Republic Bank, to really unlock that business potential through product innovation. And that same theme that we've been discussing across this conference about how to really look at how your content is flowing and make it more intelligent. How can I improve what's going on and what my users are doing? So as an active member of the tech community, Raina is passionate about redefining consumer experiences that also leverage the best next-gen technology, very much encompassing what Aaron was referencing yesterday, that we can either let tech slow us down or we can actually empower and motivate and make these workflows more efficient. So I'll actually let Raina now dive a little bit deeper into Y Media Labs.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. So Y Media Labs is a creative technology company. And what we really do is we partner with brands and with companies to create products and experiences that have a lasting impact. Not only are we looking at the end users of our products, but also the brands themselves. So we have been very fortunate. We work with, 25 of the top Fortune 500 companies. And the work that we have done has touched north of 300 million users till date. And healthcare is one of the key areas of focus for our company as we look into the next few years, fintech being the other one. And so if you look at it, both of these industries have a lot of similarities, them being regulated and similar challenges in adopting like some of the latest and greatest technology that comes out. With Apple, so we worked with Apple, we continue to work with Hospital Corporation of America and with Fresenius Medical, so we have experience across working with large corporations and also some of the more innovative startups, the ones who are trying to push the envelope when it comes to adopting some of these more recent innovations in technology, be it Alexa or, natural language processing and machine learning. With Apple, what we actually did was, using the research kit, we actually built like 6 apps on top of that research kit, and we worked that, and we did that in partnership with Mass General, Stanford, Mount Sinai, and that really helped the researchers start to acquire participants for the clinical research studies and start getting data. I mean, you would all know, like, clinical research is an exercise that takes years, and the data takes even longer to kind of come back. And, within the first few weeks of launch, we had acquired somewhere north of 60,000 participants you know, for Parkinson's, asthma, cardiac care. So that was pretty phenomenal. With Hospital Corporation of America, what we're doing is looking at creating a framework that would empower the physicians and the nurses to provide greater quality of care. And you know, how might they do that? You know, looking at that entire ecosystem and looking at the journey, you know, from communications into, you know, their day-to-day activities. You know, how do we help empower them to bring the point of care to the patient bedside if they're home? So looking at that entire connected ecosystem. And you know, with HCA, similarly with Fresenius, we're kind of working on this concept of omni-care. And the last one that you see, something that I'm very passionate about, is you know, leveraging the emerging technologies like conversational UI and machine learning and the advancements in natural language processing. And how might we use those technologies to really solve some of those patient needs? You know, for example, with you know, we work as a part of our innovation labs. We have come up with an Alexa toolkit that allows cardiac care patients recovering at home to get, you know, personalized care plans, reminders about their medications, diet plans, any upcoming appointments. And then what we've done is like looking at the entire ecosystem from physicians and nurses and hospitals, but also involving the family and those caregivers at home who are in the loop. So trying to look at, you know, how might we, you know, empower those folks so that they're, you know, ultimately we're reducing the cost of readmission into hospitals. So I'm truly excited about healthcare and how, you know, the whole digital transformation is going to happen and the role of technology in enabling that.
Yeah, and that's a really great lead, and I think to dive right into our panel here. So yesterday we heard from a number of different CIOs across the spectrum, from direct patient care to medical devices and more. What I wanted to really get from you guys, because you're looking at it from a different perspective, from the product side or from an SI side, as you're looking into these different healthcare organizations, again, payer, provider, you know, what do you think are the largest barriers to adoption? You know, what's keeping us from moving to a more cloud-first mentality within healthcare? And let's start more on the communications and EMR side, and then we'll move over to the integrator perspective. Thanks, Jonathan.
Yeah. So as I mentioned, we've been around for about 10 years, and our first go-to-market was a replacement for the SMS, which is not HIPAA compliance. So we have a very strong bias and bent toward compliance, and our first champions were the compliance officers and the legal teams of these large health systems. So we got lucky in a sense, because that is one of the biggest barriers in healthcare generally. In terms of cloud deployment, not every vendor out there is a cloud service. So lots of people make money in different ways. We are fortunate at TigerText to have a business model that is rewarded when we have higher engagement, people use our application and are happy using it. So that's just the way we are. We generally like data that comes into our system, and we generally like sharing data outside of our system to others. And so we've created or maybe stumbled into a business model that I personally think is more in line with the way modern software is, as well as what patients and end users actually want. But the barriers that we see, I go into conversations all the time where we have a wonderful use case, we know it's going to improve patient outcomes, we know the nurses want it, everybody wants it, and the vendor on the other side of the table will tell me that it's 19 months away in terms of product development because they have to, you know, they only do 3 releases a year or something like that. And that's really frustrating when you know on the other side that there are really patients that are suffering, that these things are not being accomplished. So I think the way to overcome those challenges, obviously, is we love partnering with folks like Box and others who are cloud first. Mobile first is really helpful as well. And on the other side, I'd say that in terms of challenges, there's just a lot of stakeholders, especially as you deal with the large systems. So we have adopted a very robust governance structure to figure out how do we best deploy. So how do we get virality in a hospital? How does everybody use our solution? There's a lot of people that are important to that decision process, whether it's compliance or the medical teams, the nursing teams. And so those are some of the things that we work on.
Yeah, I think one of my favorite books out there is a book by Clay Christensen. The book's called The Innovator's Dilemma. And it talks about how when you have these older infrastructures, it's really actually hard to replace them a lot of the time. Where, I'm just gonna not put names out there, but let's just say that there's a large old EHR. You guys can, in your head, you can imagine which one you're ever thinking of. And a hospital paid $50 million for that EHR. And it's not just the software, it's the hardware in the basement, it's the servers, it's the networking, it's the infrastructure in the hospital's basement. What's going to justify the cost of removing that? But at the same time, if you look at those companies that are out there, they're bumping up against huge challenges. They're not cloud-based, but they're bumping up against challenges where each installation is slightly different than another installation. So when you want to deploy new software, you come up against these huge challenges where one installation in California is not going to be like an installation in Michigan, which is not going to be like an installation in New York, which is not going to be like an installation in Florida. And when you move to the cloud, what Box has done, you literally are pushing that. You're pushing new code every day. Every single day, Box is making changes and fixing things and optimizing things, which is hugely advantageous over the long term. But fast forward, say 7 years from now, we're gonna see what, you know, it's hard to tell what the future is gonna be, but we're gonna see a lot of these older infrastructures possibly struggle. And moving to the cloud might actually make a lot more sense. So if these older infrastructures don't do that, what's gonna happen? I had a real conversation with a developer at one of these companies, and this company is killing it, making tons of money, hand over fist. But I asked the developer this one question. I said, how often do you push updates? And he said, once a year. Innovation is happening so fast now that the code needs to get deployed quicker than once a year.
No, I think that's a good point. And I wanted to jump in before we get to Nick and Raina, because I think what we just heard is that both TigerText and DrChrono are really good examples, I think, of new healthcare tech that's come up in the last decade. Because there was this huge need when we were looking at these slower, more static EMR systems or slower communication platforms or lack of communication platforms, where it's driven this hole and gap that DrChrono and TigerText, as well as many others, have come and filled. But still, there is a delay, right? A healthcare organization, a large hospital system, it's going to be struggling for them to decide, hey, I already invested, you know, $50 billion in this. It's hard for me to be able to want to bring these new technologies into my existing stack. And so I think Nick and Raina actually are coming from an area where they would be able to help and benefit from that, how they'd be able to customize and fit whatever you may be thinking of in your innovative system. So I'll let Nick then kind of dive in deeper about what he's seen be done.
Yeah. I think one thing right now across the healthcare space, it feels like it's like slowing down in order to go fast. So I feel like there was a time when it was a little bit more open and, you know, clinicians and doctors were able to like fly through these pilots and, you know, bring in something to test it out, and it was kind of accepted. And now it's there's more kind of bringing it in-house. Duke is one of our clients, and like they're really struggling with, do we do the cloud and allow that, or is everything on-prem on our own server farm? And now you're centralizing your access point of where you can enter their data system. And if you're a like someone who's trying to innovate on the inside and you're coming to us to say, how can we build this product? Well, we're kind of bottlenecked. So that's kind of sad. And the other is Epic. I don't know if that's, or we can't say that or not, but it's so big. And it's like, that's, we have another client, Oshner, who does a lot around innovation, really pushing envelope. They're out of New Orleans. And all the apps that we build are literally just integrate with Epic. So to me, I'm kind of thinking that's dangerous. Like all your stuff that you're collecting or all the tools you're providing for your physicians and clinicians to help patients, you know, reduce obesity by timing the amount of, by shortening their consumption window using an app with reminders, that's just going to live in Epic. And so they are, that just feels like a little bit of a risk going forward. And then the last thing to Daniel's point, which is well said, was when you're doing all these one-off installs, nothing is standardized. So therefore, it's hard to build any solution that's going to be able to plug into a standard system. So, you know, John's favorite word, APIs. Like, there's no, you can't build an app that's going to plug into some API. There's not a common set of endpoints. It's just, you know, so that makes a business risk. If you're trying to do a startup that's going to talk with data on the hospital side, because you're going to basically have to build 1,000 different products and then update them, you know, every day. That's, you're going to spend your whole year like doing one-off updates. So I think that's kind of it, you know, having a bunch of a large amount of the data siloed on site. The kind of desire to start pulling everything in, and the lack of standardization across kind of these data sets.
Thank you. Yeah, I couldn't agree with all the co-panelists here. You know, ourselves, we've gone through that experience when we work with some of the large corporations who have these legacy systems. It's like, imagine there's a giant boulder in your living room, and your job is to plug the holes, and there's literally no APIs that are going to talk to them. And so it's a really big challenge. And I think what's happening, I want to add to what, you know, everybody's been saying, is the rate at which technology is changing, that has heightened the expectations that consumers have. And these consumers are physicians. These consumers are nurses. They're patients. And what they're expecting is, you know, on-demand economy, sort of like the best in breed. And so to service all of that, you know, with the best experiences and given these systems, it's like a big challenge. And so where we see a lot of work is looking at a lot of the non-clinical workflows and starting from there, and maybe starting off there, because that's, you know, does not maybe contain PHI data, and that's lesser for these folks to think of as a risk. So using that as a way and using an example to kind of leapfrog this evolution with them. But yeah, with the cloud computing coming, with, you know, security becoming better on the cloud, with performance becoming better, we see now a lesser resistance. So I think that's working in our favor.
Yeah, I'd layer on just two things. Jenny made a really good point around the vulcanization of deployments. And so there's all these different systems out there that don't have like a platform around them. Underneath that, or maybe adjacent to that, there's a human at that site, or two or three humans, who know that documentation. And that documentation is probably not accessible publicly. So we as vendors, or if you are the IT manager, you have to find the person who wrote that 8 years ago, and maybe they don't even live near you, to identify what that solution is and how it was created. Versus in the cloud, you can just send a developer to a website. And this is like, I mean, we're sitting here in San Francisco, I live here, but it's like, obviously, it's just obvious, but it is not obvious when you get out in the field and you talk to systems. And so there's a human element that you have to find the humans, and you have to persuade them to help you. So that adds a lot of deal friction or deployment friction. And then on the other side, if you're involved at all in the mobile space, there is new vulnerabilities all the time. So Apple is pushing out updates, Android is pushing out updates, and on a mobile provider, you have to look at that stuff, you have to look at the vulnerabilities, and you have to adapt your apps to that. You have to follow them really closely, and you have to force your customers to be upgrading, and that happens continuously. There's no such thing as, you know, quarterly updates or anything. It's continuous.
Yeah, and let's take a pause on that, because I heard a lot of really powerful themes that each of you guys talked about, whether from an SI perspective or from a direct product perspective. There's almost this idea of this crawl, you know, walk, then run mentality. Whether it's starting initially with non-PHI information to at least make that improvement for information that's less regulated, and then moving towards, you know, a more powerful digital transformation journey. But I think what happens a lot of times along that path is it gets more and more complicated with the more regulated information that you see. So as you guys look at that and you look at your clients, what do you think would be the tangible challenges that you would make to your clients? For example, Nick, you mentioned we're building all these silo apps that are very specific, just in Epic. How are we broadening that perspective? How can people more easily access that information? I don't know if you, whoever wants to take the first bat at it.
Sure.
Sounds like I'll Nick out.
Yeah, like I feel like we try to encourage them, our clients, to think about like a middleware layer of data that now can collect and consume information from whatever product they're trying to launch and to innovate, and that can talk back and forth to their EHR or EMR. So instead of like building something like right on top of EHR, we want to try to get them to start thinking about how do they have something that's separate and in the middle that's going to be more flexible. Mm-hmm. So then that can be cloud-based. You can do more with it. It's going to allow them to scale, because with our clients, they don't always, it's not always just for their system. They want to actually launch something that might be innovative across the whole healthcare spectrum for many clinics to use or many physicians to use. So if we can like kind of start to decouple it and make it more service-oriented, like API web services, then it's going to allow them more flexibility to scale something beyond just their institution.
Yeah, and I know both Jonathan and Daniel, when you guys were looking at your products, you wanted to make sure that was really easily accessible. Can you talk about some of the ways that you've seen your APIs be used, or easier ways where you've seen whether it's content being ingested or physicians to be able to improve their workflows?
Sure. So I think one of the things that we really fundamentally, our mission, one of our missions as a company is to allow a developer-centric EHR where a developer could get on and literally start building in minutes, sort of like a developer can with the iPhone. So I'll give you a couple of examples. One is a partner of ours called Health Gorilla. They partnered with DrChrono. One challenge in building an EHR is connecting all of the labs. You have, you know, a rural physician in wherever, in the middle of nowhere, but there's a lab down the block and he wants to send a lab request to them. Health Gorilla built on our API. It's a RESTful modern API. And they send a request straight to that lab to ask to have that blood drawn for that patient. So the patient can run over there, get their blood drawn. They do the test, they send the results right back into DrChrono. And for us to integrate with all of the labs across the US would be a huge challenge, but we have a partner who's actually tackled that for us. There's other partners like ZocDoc.
Yeah.
ZocDoc's a scheduling company, essentially, and they bring patients to your practice. So some physicians like to have that patient inflow. We have other partners like Echo Devices, which is an FDA-approved wearable that snaps onto your stethoscope. And literally, you can check someone's heart rate. Sorry, you're my patient in every case. You know, you can check their heart rate, and it streams right into the EHR instead of them having to type, you know, what's going on with that patient. So APIs, I feel like, are really part of our future, whether other EHRs like it or not. It's just something, you know, as if you're running a medical institution, you kind of want to pick and choose what you want to bring into that institution. So allowing a really modern API is super critical. And that's something Box does really well. We integrate it with the Box API.
Yeah, we try to focus as much as possible on the end user. We were early to market with doctors, which are a very persnickety group of people. And they're very important to the health systems because they can walk out the door and take their patients with them. So they have a lot of credibility inside of an organization. IT can't always force them to do things in as much as they can to other departments. So one of the best use cases we have is wound care. And in any TigerText deployment, we go out and kind of do this diagram, this workflow of like, what happens now? And inevitably, every single time, it's like, somebody takes a picture of a wound, they make 17 phone calls, nobody calls them back, and then finally they get a response. There's just like a whole bunch of buckets of workflows in between. So what we do now with TigerText is you can take a picture on your phone within TigerText, the picture does not get stored down to the phone, and then we can share it through Box to anybody else. So you can just, I guess our end users just want these things to work. They have they bring their iPhone to work and they want these things to work. They have consumer expectations in an enterprise arena, and that's what's so challenging if you're sitting there and you're in charge of the IT spend for a hospital. You've got all these people with wonderful, you know, consumer apps, and like, well, now, you know, Monday to Friday, I walk into my work and everything's crappy, right? They don't want that. So we try, from an API perspective, we try to make to the end user everything invisible. You know, TigerText and Box work great together. You want to send a file, go ahead. You want to bring a file up and share it with a colleague, cool. Underneath the hood, we've got developers working on it, and it just happens to be pretty easy.
Yeah, and I think one thing that I'm hearing you all mention is that innovation is possible. There's pockets of it, whether it's integrations within TigerText, within DrChrono, what you're building at Duke, what you're thinking about doing at HCA with Alexa as well. It is possible, but there's still almost this hesitation that I think happens. And so if you had almost all of the ingredients necessary for innovation, you're working with your ideal client, really, what would that look like in order to challenge them to start improving those processes and start thinking APIs first to be able to make it, again, more specific and customized to what their technical stack is? What would those challenges be?
Okay,
Yeah. So one of the things where we really encourage our customers to think about is the entire customer journey. So we really go back to putting the user at the heart and center and looking at that entire ecosystem from that lens. That really helps us determine what is that vision that we're building for, and what kind of innovation or, you know, third-party implementations or integrations we need to bring in to basically enable that, you know, bigger vision. So for example, with, you know, let's talk about Alexa. When we looked at that entire ecosystem that consisted of like connected devices from like smart weighing scales to like smart blood pressure monitoring equipment to smart like oxygen meters. And what we really wanted was to create this frictionless experience wherein the patients are at home and, you know, they get prompts and the machine has that intelligence to detect and be contextual in asking them. So if they've already taken that data, you know, if that's already available, they don't ask for that. So again, by keeping that higher goal in mind, by keeping the customer and the user in mind and what we're trying to solve for, that's what we encourage them. And then again, like going back to the fact that it all has to be modular, it all has to be APIs, that allows us to be scalable and integrate going forward into either their legacy systems or to the middle layers, more importantly, or bring in any other new technology like machine learning, you know, for data analytics, for example.
I'll have a short one. I was just gonna say, you know, I guess we are all kind of getting stuck a little bit on, you know, let's make this RESTful, let's make it web services, but I think it starts at the highest level of like the CIO of a system or CTO of a system. Really, in my mind, it's about having a mindset shift to go from defense to offense. So if you want to see encourage innovation, which is going to get you the best people, you have to have an offense mindset. And I don't get corrupted and like, you know, have everything just leak out there and be exposed to a ton of liability, but like, how do you go from, you know, we're closing in and so that we don't have a mistake to let's do what we can to prep ourselves to encourage innovation with an offensive mindset?
Yeah, I actually like what you said.
Sports.
I mean,
defense and offense, got it.
It's a really good way to think about it where, you know, there are different parties. There's the software vendor, EHR, and then there's the organization running their organization. And when you go to the EHR, a lot of the time they might just say no because they don't want to deal with it. Or maybe their culture is let's build it for them and charge them more. Navigate persistently with the EHR vendor, I would say, because the EHR, in effect, is, you know, working for you, right? So definitely be persistent in that sense, where you can maybe get something for that integration and that innovation. And I'm sure you're dealing with this a lot, where you'll get a CIO who's very passionate and convinces that vendor to do something that they normally wouldn't do because their culture is, we don't do that.
All right, so with that, we're actually going to open it up. We're going to open it up to audience questions. So if you are thinking of a certain situation or a certain customization or integration, you want to ask them about it or ask them from any perspective of where your company is at, don't hold back. We can keep this awkward pause for a while.
Yes.
Give me 1 second. We have to actually keep the questions on mic.
So that's great, innovative work you've all done. Quick question for Raina. You mentioned the app that you built for doctors and they were trying to get patients into their clinical research studies. Can you talk more about that and how that worked out? Was it a specific app based on the type of patients that they were looking for, and if you could just talk about that.
Sure. Yeah, so that engagement was with Apple, and they had come up with the whole concept of a research kit. It was an open source framework, and what they wanted to do was bring this whole concept of, you know, basically democratizing medical research. And so how can you work with leading institutions who are focusing on Alzheimer's or cardiac care or diabetes to use this to recruit participants? So now using this mobile, which just sits in your hands and, you know, it's with all of us, You could easily connect and reach out to folks, easily screen them, shortlist them, and have them, you know, have the devices start monitoring their daily behavior, you know, their sleep cycles, or, you know, how much they walk and stuff like that. So all of this data was now going back live into each of these medical institutions, so they could take better, you know, or basically start justifying the hypotheses that they have for their clinical research studies.
I'll tack onto that. So, you know, in our healthcare practice, if you call it that for a small company like us, there's kind of research and then clinical, but on the research side, it's a specific use case. It's mothers who are maybe predisposed to postpartum depression. We want to track certain characteristics over the 9 months postpartum. That used to be form-based, and now research kit makes it very easy with authorized consent and or informed consent. To build that, scaffold up an app real quick and launch it. I think where there's more room to run is, these numbers might be right, but if you had 1,000 participants in a study, you're like doing great, you're jumping for joy. So how do we start to think about how, but what we see is we just replaced the paper form with the app, and we still have 1,000 people in our study. So they're not democratizing it yet. They need to figure out ways to actually think like a startup, think like a growth hacker, and like go out and get 100,000 people in this study. It doesn't have to be limited to just the people you recruit if you set it up the right way. So I think that's another wave in clinical research that we will see soon.
Yeah. What's good is that now you have this this platform to work off on. And I think now it goes down into each of these institutions leveraging it to the best capacity and getting more folks in just so that you can get better outcomes.
Any other questions?
This question is for Daniel. I'm curious to know, I hear a lot of, in my innovation team, I work a lot with companies who are like, yeah, you know what, we integrate into EHRs and we push data and we pull data, and kind of look at them with a bit of skepticism just because I know there's some capabilities that are there and some they're not. So I think there are two questions. One, what is your kind of recommendation when people say stuff like that, like, yeah, we could pull and we could push in at EHRs? And two, I'd love to kind of hear your perspective of where EHRs are going in the future. Like, what is the kind of roadmap you think is going to be the next big trend around EHRs and the data and the normalization and standardization of data that's going to happen or may happen?
Sure. So your first question was around, we integrate with EHRs. I would say be skeptical. And they may actually be telling the truth, but they might be integrated with one installation at one hospital. That may not work anywhere else. And then they would have to go out and actively ask that same vendor to make that integration happen at another hospital, which may actually be different. There is one older, it's not an API, but it's like a standard called HL7. And HL7, so I kind of think of it like this, was the de facto for many, many years. And HL7, if I send you a piece of data, like what's a good piece of data? Like a glucometer reading. If I send that to you, in HL7, it may or may not have a title, so you may just have a data point, and you can, that data point might be, you know, it might be field 27. How's anybody gonna know that? Because you can change it, at HL7, you can do anything you want. There's no, it's like a free-for-all, essentially. So I think when you come and talk to these vendors, just say, how many integrations have you done? Is it a cloud vendor EHR? Because if it's a cloud EHR, it's actually fairly easy. With DrChrono, when you do an integration, it connects to all of our users, and we can turn it on depending on the user like that. But if it's an install in a hospital, be extremely cautious, because one install or one version of HL7 is one version of HL7. You know, one connection is one connection. But they're not lying, they do have an integration.
So as a vendor in the space and running into many other vendors that make these statements, I'll give you a few things that you can ask. There's a big difference between reading data from an EHR and writing data to an EHR. Huge fundamental difference. A lot of data you can get out from an EHR through HL7, which is, or through some sort of middleware, they'll be pushing you data. It may or may not be coming from that end source directly. So ask that question, can you read, and what can you read specifically, and what can you write back? And then document which versions of which software, and get reference points for each customers for which they've done that, because there are multiple different versions. On the write side, there are a lot of vendors that can write back into an EHR into very specific areas, like a notes tab, which is a relatively easy place to write into, but not into the direct clinical record. So a lot of the vendors will not give you access to that, or they have to go through a whole bunch of hoops to actually write back into different areas of the record.
And I think the second question was, what's the future that you see for an EMR data?
Doing all of that. this data model needs to be accessible, it needs to be patient-centric, and it needs to be able to be shared in real time across pretty much any variable. And that's a challenge not only for EMRs that have business models that don't align with sharing data, and they see one of their core products as a data infrastructure. It's also, to be honest, quite a challenge for providers who may not want data portability as well, because they see that as competitive risks. So there's a couple different layers to it. You probably
know. Yeah, that was actually really great. I do think that EHRs are going to fundamentally change. It's not going to be what we think it is today. I think that there's going to be a lot more data just being collected by things around you. You mentioned Alexa. You know, that's one device that may be able to just collect information. I think, you know, the one partner that I mentioned up here is Echo Devices, where it literally takes all the recordings from your heart rate and just places it into the EHR. If we can do more of that, then the doctor can have that interaction more and more. And I think that there's going to be, you know, it's not going to be one aha moment where, like, everything changes. It's going to be incrementally year after year after year over the next several years. The medical record's going to become very easy down the road. And it's a timing thing. I don't think it's a, for me, I actually have a really optimistic view of the future of EHRs. That's why we're doing it, what we're doing. I think, you know, physicians are actually going to be able to, like, take that time with the patient, and data will be collected. And, you know, one of the things we're doing, the iPad, we really focus on the iPad quite a bit, where how do you get data into that device when the patient is saying things so fast to you and you only have 15 minutes with that patient? If you can do that well, I mean, all of you guys have a phone on you that has no buttons anymore, right? There's effectively no buttons. You talk to somebody 20 years ago and they'd be like, you're crazy, right? But now the interface of that iPhone or that tablet device can change to whatever you want. I think, you know, the medical record of the future is going to be very, it's going to be fun. I think it'll be, like, really fun to see, like, where things go. I'm wearing my medical record on my wrist. I have the personal health record for DrChrono. We coined it the wearable health record, where, like, if you have an issue, you know, you can literally just pull up information on your wrist.
I have a follow-up question for Daniel. So how do you see you talked about the future, right? What I'm curious to know is, how will AI and ML play a role in that, and how are you bringing that in early into your product?
That's a really great question. We're just starting to think about AI and machine learning as a company. I think one of the things that would be interesting, and this is for Box, there's a lot of images that are placed into Box, radiology images, these sorts of things. Right now you need a radiologist to, like, review that, and it's expensive. Radiologists are expensive, it takes their time. Imagine if we had AI that could detect abnormalities. The cost would go drastically down, so anybody could get, you know, a radiology image done for, like, fractions of a penny, right? If we go down that route of, like, AI. So it'd be super interesting to see, like, the radiologist isn't even there, and it just says there's something going strange because, you know, I've reviewed billions of radiology images as an AI.
I mean, at the very least, it'll do that initial triage, so the time spent goes down considerably, and that's when you really have the physician focusing on the care and being more focused there and looking at the data to help make better decisions.
Right. Makes sense.
I actually had a question, as in the last minute, if no one else has a question. Never mind.
Go ahead, ask yours.
No, no. We're doing first. I asked a lot of questions.
I guess this is for all, since you all kind of play a different role in the space. But I think a common theme across the industry, whether you're a doctor, a nurse, you know, a staff member, C-suite, or even the patient, that everybody seems to feel either, you know, overworked, undervalued, underappreciated, misunderstood, misguided. So along the entire process, you always just feel like you're chasing something and never going towards what you want to have accomplished. Is there kind of a vision, a goal, a like three key buzzwords or just something that is guiding you that you think needs to guide the industry so that ultimately like value-based care can actually be valuable? Does that make sense?
Yeah. We think, as I mentioned, the workflow. So, Rachel, 25 seconds on the clock here. So,
the music soon.
We think of workflows and so those phone calls versus, so we're giving time back. The gentleman yesterday who spoke from Pacific Dental Services and said the way he, as the IT manager, he influences people to purchase his solutions by saying, I'm going to give you 15 minutes back.
Right.
And that's what everybody's asking for. And I think that's a really useful concept. So how can I make your busy life a little less busier? How can I solve something, interrupt something? And then also, how do I change the way you think about these things so it's not scary that we can change it?